Hello,
Baruch
Hi, how are you?
Hashem.
Baruch Hashem. Hi, Mayor. How are you doing? Good.
Baruch Hashem.
You know what? I am at a wedding here. My wife likes to go to a wedding,
Hi.
and I have to follow through. She's like you used to like to go to all these dinners. My wife is pushes me for all these weddings and things like that.
Quite understandable. She's right. Where are you? Williamsburg.
Now this time in Bronx, Marina Del Rey.
Bronx.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, with Eden.
No, mit Eden. Yeah.
No, mit Eden.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, jetzt wird man unheiben gelernen. Darf sein. Unfang von der Umid. So the Gemara is discussing over here of Yesh Yad. It means that if you issue a partial statement, right? So that's yad. Now, in order to effectuate a neder, you have to say the full statement. That's understood. You say this piece of food should be usher to me. That's a neder. But we know that there's sometimes you don't have to say the full statement. The pasuk says that if you say just a partial statement, it's good. But how far did the pasuk go? So we had this machlokes. But basically everybody agrees by a neder, there's something called a yad, which means that if you issue a partial statement, but it's understood that you want to make a neder, right? It's 90% we know, but you didn't say the word usser. For example, you said, like our Mishnah gives an example, mudrani mecha, I'm a vow to you, sha'ani oichaloch, that I'm not eating from you, whatever I eat. So then it's a neder that we saw in the Mishnah. So the Gemara wants to know, would you say that in other areas in the Torah? So the first question the Gemara asks, the first line of Dav Zayin Omer Aleph, Yesh Yad L'Tzdoka or Ein Yad L'Tzdoka. If a man issues a partial statement regarding giving tzedakah, does he have to follow through on that statement? Or Ein Yad L'Tzdoka? Or we don't say that there's a partial statement for tzedakah. So the Gemara says like this, Hey Chidomi, give me a case. Ilema, would you say, the Amar, he said, Hadein Zuzal Tzedakah. This dollar should be for Tzedakah. And then he says, V'hadein Nami. To the next dollar, he said, this also. So the Gemara says, so V'hadein Nami, this also, Ahu Tzedakah Atzmahi. That's giving the second dollar to tzedakah. That's not a yad. Saying v'hadein nami is not a yad. That's obvious that you're almost like a complete statement over there. Ela kagoin da amar hadein, this. V'loy oman nami, and he didn't say also. My, what's the din? In other words, he gave one zuz to tzedakah. And then he said, v'hadein, this. What is that considered a partial statement? And now, what would mean the din? He says, even if he says, I thought I'm giving it to tzedakah, right? But because it's a partial statement, perhaps he doesn't have to follow through if, perhaps he doesn't have to follow through if he wants to back out. So the Gemara's question is, hadein name tzedakah? Is the word hadein a tzedakah? Or kamar oidilma vohadein, when he says this, lenafkusa bi alma kamar, he says this, I'm going to spend somewhere else. Biburo de la aske. And he didn't finish his words, but basically he meant to say not that this second dollar goes to tzedakah. He says that this is I'm going to use to buy a drink. Me, so what's the din? So let's say, even if, since the words are not clear, if he changes his mind, he could probably back out. But maybe not. Me, I'm reading, do you say, keeping the ishkas the carbonus, since tzedakah is similar to a carbon, like a neder, the ksiv beficha, is a posik that compares in the same posik that says, lo yashachal, lo yashachal, lo shalmai, talks about carbonus, it also talks about tzedakah, zu tzedakah. The word beficha in that posik refers to tzedakah. And will darshan, ma carbonus yesh lem yad, just like carbonus, a partial statement, you have to follow through on a partial statement. Av tzedakah, so also by tzedakah, yesh lo yad, that there is a partial statement and you can't back out of it. Oy dilma, maybe lebal ta'acher hu de'iskash. Maybe the only comparison to karbonos is that tzedakah has an iser to delay, just like you can't delay a carbon. If you're obligated to bring a carbon, so then they give you 3 yamin toivim to make sure to fulfill your obligation. Otherwise, you get a licesse, a negative commandment. So we say like this, if someone has money that he set aside for tzedakah, he has 3 yamin toivim to make sure that that tzedakah gets into the hands of a poor person. If not, he'll be over that avera bal ta'acher. Only in that limited area is karbonos juxtaposed to tzedakah. But regarding partial statements, maybe yad only works by carbon, right? But not by tzedakah. That's what the Gemara's question is. Now, I want to point out to you, there is a concept that tzedakah, if you think that in your mind, you settled in your mind to give tzedakah, you might have to follow through on that. That could be. But what we're talking about over here is that he never was thinking in his mind that thought process should make it tzedakah. He wanted to use his words to make tzedakah. In that case, because he said words, so his mind, whatever he was thinking about, is not what makes the tzedakah. It's the words what's making the tzedakah. And since he used the partial words, perhaps there's no such thing of a partial statement regarding tzedakah. The Gemara leaves it unresolved. Next question is, yesh yad lehefker. If someone wants to make something hefker, he wants to make it free for everybody, right? Would you say a partial statement would make something hefker? Or maybe it doesn't. Again, all these questions are based on the fact is that Torah only said kechol hayotzi mipiyaseh, or something like that, or extra rebuium, that partial statement is considered a full statement only by nedarim. But do we apply it to other areas in dinim? So would a partial statement be an effectuate a hefker or not? So the Gemara says, hainu tzedakah, isn't hefker similar to tzedakah? It's giving something that belongs to your way, albeit tzedakah is for poor people, and hefker, you're saying anybody can take it, but you're just removing your ownership of it. So we already asked that question. So the Gemara says, no, there could be a difference. In Tim Tzoloimer, we're theoretically talking over here. In Tim Tzoloimer, if theoretically you would say, yesh le'ad le'tzedakah, the ein hekesh le'mechzah, that there is such a thing of a partial statement regarding tzedakah, because you don't make half comparisons. And just like by karbonos, there is hekesh. Just like about Kabbonis, there is Yadois, so also by Tzedakah, there's Yaisis. So in Hefker Nami, Miyamin, Hayin Tzedakah, would you say Hefker is a type of Tzedakah? And therefore, there would be Yad, or Dilma, or maybe Sha'ani Tzedakah. Only by Tzedakah, we would say there is Yadois. There is a partial statement. The Tzedakah, Loi Chazia Elalaniyim. Tzedakah is limited, and is that you're only giving, you're removing ownership, only to give it to poor people. Oh, well, if you're only giving it to poor people, so then what's the problem? So then you don't really need, maybe that you won't need a full statement. Even a partial statement is good enough. Aval hefker, what is hefker? Bein la'aniyim, bein la'ashirim. You're giving it away that anybody, a poor person can take it, or a rich person can take it. So perhaps in order to effectuate hefker, you would need a full statement. A yadois wouldn't work. Even though it would work by tzedakah, perhaps it doesn't work by hefker. And the Gemara leaves that unresolved. Boya Ravina. Ravina asked the question. Here is a very interesting question. If you're building a bathroom in your house, let's say you're doing over your house, and you're designating a certain room to be your bathroom. Even if nobody used it, right? The fact that you said this is where the plumbing is going and the bathroom is going to go, midrabbanan, you're not allowed to say Krishna in that bathroom. You're not allowed to say God's name in that bathroom. Because you, mazamin, you already set us designated that area to be a bathroom. So, but let's say you didn't designate it with your mouth. You only used a partial statement. Does it make it a beis hakiseh? Yesh yad le'beis hakiseh oloi. Would you say partial statements work with designating a beis hakiseh or not? Hey, chedami, how's that possible? So a man has 2 bathrooms in his house. You see, it's possible to have 2 bathrooms. back then, Ilema de Omar, he said, Hadein basically have a basic kisei. This area of my house should be a basic kisei. And this also should be a basic kisei. Ahu basic kisei nami hava. Of course, that's a full statement. He's saying this also will be a basic kisei. And therefore, it's not considered a partial statement. Elo kagoin, its example is the Om of Hadein. Again, he only said, and this room. So he said, one room, this should be the basic kisei. For the next room, he pointed and said, and this. My, Bohadain. My, what does it mean? Hodein the Omar, when he said this, Hodein Nami Basa Kise, he meant to say that this also should be a Basa Kise. Oidilma, or maybe my Bohadain. What does it mean, Lahadain? And this also, the Tashmish Be Almakoma, I'm going to use it for, you know, not a, you know, for whatever use I want. In other words, maybe he meant, and this will be used not to live in, maybe to use as a linen closet. So it's not clear. It's a partial statement. Perhaps it does not designate it as a basic kisei, even if his intention is now to make it a basic kisei. But since when he didn't verbalize that intention, so it doesn't have a din basic kisei yet, and you will be permitted to say krishma. So the Gemara asks a question, a side question. Michlal, the pshita le Ravina, the yesh jim le basic kisei. Ravina was by Ravina, it was clear that a person with just verbalizing could designate a basic kisei, right? Because this is whole predicated is that your words alone can dedicate a basic kisei. But v'homibayile l'Ravina, didn't Ravina have a question? He's mina l'basic kisei mahu. If you're building your house and you're designating one area as a basic kisei, Ravina had a question, would that make it a basic kisei? He wasn't clear. Or he's mina l'basic merchatz mahu. Let's say you're building a bathhouse, a mikvah in your house, and you say, oh, this should be a mikvah. Does Zimin, just by verbalizing it, does that automatically turn it into a Beis HaMerchatz, even though you didn't use it yet? Or just your verbal doesn't make it a Beis HaMerchatz. Perhaps people have to start using it in order for it to become a Beis HaMerchatz. So how could Ravina ask about Yodos when his first question should be, whether verbalization is effective making a basic kisei? Answers the Gemara, Ravina chada miboy chada kumbaboyle. It's one question that leads into the next question. Zimin moyel or ain zimin moyel? Would designating a basic kisei be effective or not? In Aleph Taflamit stands, im tim tsuloyim yei zimam. If you want to say that verbalizing makes a basic kisei, yesh yad or yad, would a yad be a, would can you do a partial statement be effective or not? So the Gemara says ti boyale, let that these questions remain unresolved. So the Ran, which makes the Ran in this case in this Masechta very unique, will tell you what the halacha is, and you probably could figure out the halacha for a partial statement. Let's say the Gemara had the question about partial statements regarding kedushin. Let's say, can a partial statement make a kedushin? You say to one lady, Hareya Mukudashasli, and then you said to the next lady, Bahadein, and you. Maybe he meant you also, or maybe he meant, and you observe what I'm doing. So most likely he meant to be Mekadosh Jashisha, but you need to verbalize it. Is that considered enough of verbalization? So the Ran says that it would seem that Psak should be, since you're dealing with a suffix or a because you know, the question is whether this second lady is mukudeshes or not, is betrothed or not. So this is a suffix deraisa, you should go strict. But when it comes to tzedakah and giving something away, they could say go lenient, because even though it's a suffix deraisa, but pulling money out of somebody, we never pull money out of somebody unless we're 100% sure. And in that case, we should go lenient that we will say ein yadais in those cases about tzedakah. But the Ran, again, what makes the Ran unique in this Masechta is besides being like a Rashi, besides being like a Tosfos, he's also like a Psak Halacha. Again, he's written in a time when there was no Shulchan Aruch. And that's why the Ran is very long on all the Masechta, on this Masechta, making every page very short. He's Rashi, Tosfos, and Halacha all wrapped into one. Okay, new Gemara. The Mishnah said, Menuda ani lecha. The guy says, I am excommunicated. Menuda is a general term that's usually used when you want to excommunicate. And he said, whatever I eat from you should be excommunicated, which means excommunication means when you excommunicate your friend and say, I'm excommunicating, basically you're taking it upon yourself and you're not going to talk to your friend and you're not going to go within his four amas. You're just going to go on the other side of the street where he walks. Fine. You can do that, but that doesn't make his possessions usher to you. But if a guy used the word menuda, and then he uses his food, your food should be menuda to me. So the Mishnah said that doesn't mean anything. And the Mishnah said about what Rabbi Akiva said, I think maybe you should go strict on that. So Omar Abaya said, Moide Rabbi Akiva would agree, in Yamalka she'enoike. Rabbi Akiva would agree that when it comes to Malkus, you don't get, if a guy violated this type of vow, you wouldn't get Malkus, because Rabbi Akiva says it's doubtful. I'm not sure if it's a nether or not. And if so, because if Rabbi Akiva held that it's a full-fledged nether, Nisnei, let the Mishnah say, Rabbi Akiva machmir. He was strict. Instead, the Mishnah says, Rabbi Akiva hoyechoychech bo lahachmir. He closed his lips. He pursed his lips and he made a face like he wants to be machmer, but he didn't outright say go strict. So therefore, because he wasn't 100% sure, even Rabbi Akiva would agree that you don't get Malkus, but you should conduct yourself strictly. Amar Rapapa. Rapapa explained a few things. If someone says Nedina Minach, if he says Nedina Minach, the word Nedina, instead of, it's an odd word. So that is slang words that easily fits into a neder word. The kuli alma loy pligi, the osser. Everybody would agree that's a neder word, right? Although it's similar to a cheirim word, but nadina lach is more, it sounds like neder. So that could be used as a neder word, neder word. The last line, Mishamta minach, I am in cherem from you. So that's the wrong word. Even if he said your food should be in cherem, kuli al mashari, then it's permitted to have his food. You can't say I'm not walking and talking to his food. It's like a nonsense statement. So mishamta minach is worthless. It doesn't effectuate a neder. So what is the machlokes between Rabbi Akiva and Rabbanan? So the Gemara is going to say, the Mai Pligi, what are they arguing? So let's go back to the Gemara. We're going to Zion Amid Beis. B'menuda ani l'cha. If someone said, I am menuda from you. The Rabbi Kiva Sava, Rabbi Kiva says, Lishna dinidu'yehi. It's a Lishna, it's a language like similar to Neder. And therefore, it's like I'm going to be removed from you. It doesn't mean that I'm going to be removed from your food, but it doesn't mean I'm putting your food in cheirim. V'rabbanan savrei lishna de misham tonahu. It's a lishna. It's an expression of putting something in cheirim, and basically you're saying I'm not talking to your food, which is nonsense. And therefore, Rabbanan said it's nothing. Now, this what we said before that mishamatna by food in cheirim, even Rabbi Kiva would hold it's permitted. Is not everybody holds like that. Upliga de Rav Chizda. The Rav Chizda argued, and he held that Rabbi Kiva was even strict when you use the word mishamatna. Now who gavra? There was this man, the Amar. He said to his friend, mishamatna benichse devrei Rav Yirmiyah bar Abba. The possessions belonging to the son of Rav Yirmiyah bar Abba, I'm putting in cheirim. So mishamatna. So also the kami de Rav Chizda. They came to Rav Chizda and asked him, is it a nether? Amalei, he said, it's not a nether because less laid the choshla lahod Rabbi Akiva. Nobody concerns himself with Rabbi Akiva. Kesava, because Rav Chizda held the mishamatna pligi, that Rabbi Akiva would hold, even by mishamatna, it should be considered to be a nether. So Rav Chizda said, nobody holds like Rabbi Akiva. It's only the Rabbanan. We paskin like the Rabbanan. Mishamatna is considered to be a cherem language, and therefore it's the wrong use of language. So there's no neder chal. Okay, new Gemara. Okay, Amar Rav Ila Amar Rav. Rav Ila said in the name of Rav. Now, again, you can put somebody in cherem. Let's say you put your friend in cherem. Now, why would you put your friend in cherem? Perhaps you saw him do something so terrible that you put him in cherem, and therefore you don't want to talk to him, speak to him, or go into his dalaramas. Anybody could do that. But I would think that if you're a, let's say a Rebbe in a yeshiva, then everybody in the yeshiva has to follow if you put somebody in cherem. If you're a head of a household, then everybody in your family should follow and not talk to that person if you put somebody in cherem. So Rab Ilo Amarav said, Nidahu Befonav, if you put somebody in cherem while he was there, you told him, I'm putting you in cherem, right? So Ein Matirin Loi El Befonav. If you want to undo the cherem, if you want to now speak to the friend, and if you want to now have a conversation with him or go into his Dalet Amos, you have to undo it only by calling him back. And I guess you have to have like a bezdin that undoes this nether. It's like you mat the nether. So it's almost like a nether that you said, I'm not speaking, I'm not going into your Dalet Amos. So you need to do it while the person is standing there. Because when you first originated that cherem, he was there, he was standing there. But nido shloi befonav, if you did it while he was not standing there, matir loy, then you can undo it, bein befonav, bein shloi befonav. Whether he's in front or whether he's not present, you can undo it. So what's the reason for that? So others want to learn that since you put somebody in cherem and you're not talking about him, and you committed yourself that you're not going to go into his Dalet Amos and have anything to do with him, you're just going to ignore his presence. So when you want to make amends for that, for due respect, you do it in front of while he's present and say that I put you in cherem, but now I regret it and I'm now undoing the cherem. So he should be present. Others learn that if you put him in cherem and then when he wasn't present, you undid the cherem, you went to three people and you undid the cherem. Let's say somebody from your household starts, you know, dealing with him. The person that you put in cherem is going to come to think that, oh, wait a second, I'm supposed to be in cherem. What's his son talking to me? So he's going to make fun of the whole cherem business. So therefore, Rav says that if you put somebody cherem while he's present, and you tell him in his face, I'm putting you in cherem. So then when you want to undo it, you have to make sure that he's present. Another piece, a very interesting Gemara right now. Amar Rav Chanan, Amar Rav. Rav Chanan said in the name of Rav, Hashomea haskar shem epi chaver. Somebody he hears from his friend that he always saying God. He's always saying God's name in vain, right? He's making brachas for no reason. He's just using God's name for nothing. Sorech lenadoisi. You have to put such a person in cherem. Because just to show how strict that he's violating a very strict commandment of not saying God's name in vain. Vim loini dahu, if you don't put him in cherem, if you're tolerant of that, who wants me hey benidin? Gemara gives you like a curse that they should put you in cherem in heaven. Because it was common to be a little bit passive when you hear somebody using God's name in vain. And the Gemara explains what's wrong with using God's name in vain. Terrible thing. Shekol mokom shaskar same mishtsuya. When every somebody who uses God's name in vain, just for the sake, shom anias mitsuya, that will bring to poverty. Because the pasuk says that whenever you mention God's name, the b'chol mokom shaskar shmi ovei alecha uveirachticha. Whenever you mention my name, says God, I'm going to come there and bless you. But that only applies if you can mention God's name. But if you start saying God's name for no reason, or in the wrong and not in the framework of a bracha, that could lead to poverty. Because the opposite of bracha is poverty. Va'anias is kemitza. Someone who the Gemara adds this point that someone who's poor, it's almost like he's dead. Shneimar, because the pasuk says that when God told Moshe Rabbeinu, you can now return to Mitzrayim. He was with his father-in-law Yisrael, and Hashem said, go to return to Mitzrayim. So God said, Ki mesu kol ha-nashim, that those people that were trying to seek you out, which was Dasan and Aviram, died. Now, God said they died, but really they didn't die because we find the same Dasan and Aviram and many, many years later by the Machlekes of Kairach. So they didn't die. So what did Hashem say they died? So they lost, it must be that they died in the sense that they lost their wealth. They lost their influence in its tribe. And they died. As the Ran explains, we can't say they became blind or sick because that wouldn't stop them from at least having the same influence that they had. But once they lost their wealth, so then in the eyes of Paroi, they're considered dead. They're no more in the game. And therefore, God was telling Moshe that it's safe to go back to Mitzrayim. So what you do see from here is that having poverty, lo yaleinu, is almost like death. So therefore, how to avoid poverty? You see from here that if you so respect to God's name, you're careful about shemus, or you're careful about, how the family says Hashem's name, or making sure that you say brachas correctly, and for the right food and the right bracha. If someone is very careful about hilchas brachas, it automatically brings wealth. That's what the Gemara is saying. So it's an incentive to learn more. Tanya would learn to the Maraisa. When Chachamim wanted somebody to get punished, or they either invoke death on the person, or poverty. One more piece of Gemara, and then we'll end. Omar Rababa said, two more pieces. Have a kamina coming to Rav Huna. I was in front of Rav Huna. Shemo lahach itzisa d'apka shmor shem levatola. Rav, in front of Rav Huna, a lady said God's name in vain. Shamta, he put her in cherem, just to teach her a lesson. But usharlo leila alter ba'apa. He undid his cherem right away, in front of her face. Shema mina tla. So you see three halachas from that story. Shema mina hashemei askar shem b'pichaveira tzarech lenadaisi. If you hear somebody say God's name in vain, you're supposed to put him in cherem. Ushma mina, and you hear nido b'fonav. If you put somebody in cherem in front of him, ein matirin ela b'fonav. You should try to undo that cherem only when he's present. So Rav made sure that the lady was present. She didn't go home yet, and he right away undid the cherem that he put her in. Ushma mina, and you hear from that story, ein bein din di lahafar v'lo klum. You could put somebody in cherem and then undo the cherem and nullify the cherem in 5 minutes later. So you could put somebody in cherem and then nullify the cherem. Because the whole point of cherem, although technically cherem should be 30 days, but if the whole point of cherem is just to put somebody in a more serious mindset and to make a point, you could put him in cherem and right away undo it. One last piece of Gemara. Amar Rav Gidol Amar Rav. Talmud Chochem Menada La'atzmi Mefil La'atzmi. Wow. He could put himself in cherem. In other words, he could say that I'm in cherem and therefore I don't want to have anything with people. I'm going to be a recluse. And I Mefil La'atzmi. But he can take himself out of cherem very fast. So the Gemara says, Pshita, why can't he take him out? Why can't he undo it? So Gemara says, Mahu Desema Ein Chavish Matar Atzmi Beis Asurim. Somebody who's jailed cannot release himself from jail. Somebody has to undo the jail in order for him to get released. Kamash Malam. Because let's say you make a neder. If you make a neder and you're a Yochid Mumcha, somebody who can undo the neder by yourself, you can't undo your own personal neder. But that's by a neder. But by cherem, if you put yourself in cherem, and so basically you're saying I can't be around people, you can undo it if you're a Talmud Chacham, if you're like a Yochud Mumcha. Hey Chedomi, give me a case of a person putting himself in cherem and undoing it. Kihoda Mazutra Chasidik. Mar says a fascinating thing. Mazutra the Chasid. Ki Mechaye Bei Rav Shamta. When he was a Shiva boy who was supposed to be put in cherem, maybe let's say the Shiva boy was Mechal Shabbos, and he had to put the kid in cherem. So, he didn't put the boy in cherem and nobody in the yeshiva should talk to him. What he did was mishamet nafshe bereisha. He put himself in cherem first. He said, I should be in cherem. No one should talk to me. Then he put the yeshiva boy into cherem. In other words, he wanted to fix himself up first. If he is ready to put somebody else in cherem, first put yourself in cherem, fix yourself, and then, you can give musa to other people. So that's what he did. But when he got home that day, sorry lenafshe, he would take himself out of cherem. In other words, now he's home, so he has to be with his family. And then he would right away remember to undo the cherem that he put the yeshiva boy in. So it's a fascinating thing, and it's fascinating how they dealt with issues that they need to send a lesson to people. But Rav Maharal Zutra put himself in cherem before he put somebody else in cherem. Okay, so ends our learning.
Enjoy the chasana.
Yes, I thank you very much. Okay, good night.
A gute Nacht. Bye.